Climate change is getting worse, and you're going to notice it. That's the message from the White House this week in a new report. According to that report, indigenous people in the U.S. are feeling the impact right now. In the Great Lakes, tribes can't grow rice anymore because it's too warm and water levels are too high. Drought is killing crops and livestock in the Southwest, and it's not just the U.S. Adventurer and Professor Aaron Doering has been traveling to the most remote areas in the world since 2011, and he sees the impact firsthand.
They want to have the people in the South to understand how things are changing here. And there's a common strand, there's a common theme that goes throughout, and that theme is that things have changed drastically here within the last 30 years especially.
It's much warmer in the summer, and the season is getting earlier and earlier.
Doering and his team have planned 7 expeditions, one to each continent over 4 years. Well, he just got back this week from the 6th journey to Nepal. All right, he's joining me now from Minneapolis, where he is also the associate professor at the University of Minnesota. Good to see you, Aaron.
Good morning. It's good to be here.
So in a nutshell, what is your mission when you go on these expeditions?
What we want to do is put a face to climate change. So there are all these people around the world, and they want to tell their story. And so we're going using adventure learning, getting them excited to tell their story about what is happening and have people throughout the world hear it.
So you've gone to 6 out of 7 of your stops in these continents. The last one will be to Antarctica, and you just got back from Nepal. So, you know, tell us what impact you saw that climate change is actually having on people in Nepal.
Yeah, you know, in all these areas, it's very similar, no matter if you're in Australia, if you're in the Arctic, or if in Nepal. These people are being impacted greatly by the varying weather conditions. And so where they just can't grow crops like they could before. And these are people who can't go to a grocery store. And so it's subsistence living. And so they need to be able to grow their food. And now in places that we just were 2 weeks ago, they're not able to. And they're having to adapt to that change.
And why not? Why are they not able to? What's happening environmentally?
Well, what's happening is right, they're experiencing drought where they never experienced it before. They're experiencing these downpours of rain that they never experienced before. And so they're having to come up with solutions. And a solution, for example, when we were in Peru, I was with a farmer just outside of Lima. It was an area that was completely drought. Mm-hmm. And what they did is they put up literally fog harvesting nets that collected the fog. It trickled down into this barrel that then they could use that water for irrigation. So people are having to adapt to it. And it doesn't matter literally where you are. You're seeing it as we've seen it on all the 6 continents.
So as you saw in Peru, and people are being inventive. I mean, they're not necessarily consulting any manuals. No experts are coming into their area and introducing them to new ideas. They are trying to figure it out on their own, seeing that, okay, in that fog is moisture. Let's catch some of that moisture, and now let's feed our crops with it.
Yeah, that's correct. And so you're exactly right. And they're also trying to bring education to these villages in so that people can literally get themselves educated about the different opportunities to invest into adapting to this changing world. When we were in Nagi, this village just outside of Kathmandu, literally what they're trying to do is bring the internet there in order to keep their students there so that they can be educated so that they can adapt to this changing world.
And over time, we've heard a lot about the ice melting in the Arctic associated with climate change. Mm-hmm. It means that certain animals, you know, are having a difficult time surviving because, you know, their habitat is the ice. So what did you see in the Arctic Circle?
Yeah, you know, I spent actually a decade traveling around the circumpolar Arctic by dog team and by ski and delivering this online education program, telling stories from the people. And what you're hearing, just like the lead in there, is that they are having this early breakup of the ice in a late freeze. And what that means to these people is that, you know, they have to travel on this ice in order to go and hunt caribou, to fish Arctic char. So it's not like they can just turn and go into their grocery store, like I said.
Right.
So even their travels on the land are being impacted by this.
So what's next in your view? What happens from this information you gather? Does this mean, you know, this is a platform in which you're saying, hey, world, you got to help out these people in these places, or this is what we can learn from people who are doing these magnificent, you know, adaptive things as a result of climate change? What is the next step?
Yeah, you know, the whole goal behind this project was to literally build this tapestry of voices and to get people engaged in a dialogue around climate change. And so that's what our goal was, and that's what we've been doing. And so people can literally go online and they can share their story themselves, and from it, hopefully it inspires someone to do something different in order that we can adapt to the changing world.
All right, Aaron Doering, thank you so much. What an incredible adventure. And you've got one more stop to go and beautiful images. Yeah, beautiful images. And we're all learning so much by way of your journeys. Thanks so much. Appreciate it, Aaron. Good to see you.
Thank you.